text this morning is Job 31, verse 1. I've made a covenant with my eyes. Why then should I look upon a young woman? Today I would like to present what I consider to be the number one tool the Lord has given us in His Word to empower us for sexual consecration. Quickly, the context of our verse. Incredible calamity has exploded in Job's life, and his three friends come to help him process. And their conclusion is, Job, there must be something very wrong in your life to have this happen to you. And he is claiming, not innocence, but he's claiming, there is no big, bad, ugly sin in my life to explain what's happened to me. The discussion gets so intense that it reaches an apex in chapter 31, where Job, with his back to the wall, is forced to start to defend how he has walked in righteous living. The first thing out of his mouth, he says, guys, this has not happened to me because I have compromised with my eyes. In fact, I made a covenant with my eyes before God as it regards sexual consecration. I want you to notice he did not say, I made a resolve or a commitment. He said, I made a covenant. It's a sledgehammer word. It takes us back to Abraham and the Lord, where the Lord passes between the pieces as a burning oven. It's a scary word, covenant. I've got a definition of covenant in your notes. I want you to see that the Bible does not present a covenant with our eyes as a command. The context of the verse is a narrative. So I'd like to suggest it comes to us as an invitation. Now, what the Bible does command is absolute purity. What it doesn't command is how you get there. So whether you use this tool or not, that is voluntary for you. But I consider that if the Holy Spirit has given me a biblical tool in His Word for purity, I might do well to give it serious consideration. I'd like to give you my history with this verse. Going back 7 years, I was in my daily Bible reading, and as is my custom to read through the Bible, I was in the book of Job, and it just happened to come to chapter 31 in my daily reading, and I'm like, yes, Job 31:1, it's my verse. I've preached this one. I've pursued with a strong resolve purity all my days. And so I'm in the verse and I'm praying it again. I'm saying, yes, Lord, sign me up for this again. I don't want to see her. I want to see you. And Lord, I'm just saying, yes, Lord, yes, give it to me again. And as I'm praying in this manner, the Lord kind of interrupts my prayer and whispers to my heart, you know, you've never actually done it. And I was like, you mean make a covenant? Well, no, Lord, you know, I've never actually made a covenant with my eyes. I mean, that's scary. That's like a vow. Of course, I've never made a covenant with my eyes. But I was busted. I had been saying yes to a verse without actually saying yes to it. And so now I'm like, oh man, I'm in trouble. Lord, are you actually inviting me to make a covenant with my eyes? And so I took about a week with it because, I mean, I am really on the edge with this thing. And so I took about a week to pray over it. And after testing it, it just seemed to me there is a window of grace open to me right now in the Holy Spirit. I just feel like God's giving me an invitation. Would you want to make a covenant? And so I said yes. I wrote it out, dated it, put it in my journal, gave a big offering because I couldn't afford to forget it. And now, I mean, it was the scariest day of my life. What did I just do? But I want to testify, 7 years later, the day I made that covenant with God, with my eyes, it was like I crossed the line. The difference was immediate. It was measurable. It was real. And it has endured to the present day. And now the Lord has just been kind of putting pressure on me to share this with the body of Christ. And so, if you don't mind, I'd like to go there this morning. Picture your life as a castle. Back in olden times, a city would have these huge walls around it, and then they'd have a gate. And when invaders wanted to take over an ancient city or a castle, they would always target the gate, because the gate was the most vulnerable part of the structure. When the enemy is after your life in terms of your sexuality, he always comes after the gate. Penetrate the gate, you get on the inside. Once you're on the inside, it's over. And so the gate to our sexuality, I would like to suggest, is the eyes. The adversary wants access through our eyes, because once he gets on the inside, then he's able to have his way in our hearts and in our thought life. But we have got to shut the eye gate, get the enemy on the outside of the castle. Now the war's not over, it's just fightable. Now with the enemy on the outside of the castle, you can engage him from a place of advantage and take on the real battle, which is 2 Corinthians 10:5, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. But you will never get traction in your fight for 2 Corinthians 10:5 as long as there is a crack in the eye gate. So we want to slam that thing shut. Somebody says, well, a covenant with the eyes, it seems kind of overly traumatic to me. Isn't this a little bit of overkill? And I'd like to suggest that it's a proportionate response to the intensity of today's war. Do I have to convince you that we're in a war today? Compromise is accessible, affordable, anonymous. One click on that device in your hand and you're going there. At the end times, Revelation 14 gives it to us, at the end times, there is going to be a company of unprecedented purity that will be undefiled with women, following the Lamb wherever he goes. So at the end of the age, when immorality is at its height, there is going to be a generation of unprecedented purity. And I'm like, how are we going to get that generation at the end of the age? And I have only one answer for it. They will make a covenant with their eyes. And if you're going to lead that generation, you're going to have to make a covenant with your eyes too, because we can only lead people where we have gone ourselves. Now change metaphors, please. Moving from the castle metaphor, I'd like you to see your life as a car. To drive a car, you've got to have a gas pedal and a brake pedal. And in our pursuit of consecration, I'd like you to see the gas pedal as the love of Christ and the brake pedal as the fear of the Lord. The love of Christ, like a gas pedal, that catapults us, that thrusts us into purity. And I want that thing, I want a peppy gas pedal. But we also need a brake pedal that when we're headed in the wrong direction, the brakes actually work. And the brake pedal is the fear of the Lord. And I want both of these to be like a fire in my bosom, a fire of passion for Jesus that drives me into purity, and then a fiery inferno of the fear of the Lord in my heart that stops me when I'm headed in the wrong direction. The main reason I have made a covenant with my eyes, I'm about to tell you. It's one verse. Matthew 5:8. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. I want to see God. It's everything I'm living for. It's the dream, the passion, the motive of everything that I do. Actually, I am interested in an audience with the King. I want a face-to-face with my beloved, like Abraham had, like Moses had, like Ezekiel had, like Paul, like John. I want to see God like Job saw God. Listen. The man who made a covenant with his eyes was the man who one day saw God. That connection is not lost on me. Jesus, this is why I am after your heart. I want to see you. I want to know you. I want an audience with you. And so I am pursuing purity, the love of Christ, the pursuit of his heart. It's everything I live for, and I want this gas pedal to be something that absolutely thrusts me forward into purity and passion and devotion. However, if all you have is a gas pedal and no brake pedal, you are eventually going to crash. Same is true in our consecration. If all you have is the love of Christ but have no fear of the Lord working in you, I promise you, you're headed for an accident. When Jesus came to the church at Thyatira, he commended them for their love. He said, when it comes to passion, when it comes to love, you guys got it. But then he rebuked them for their sexual immorality. Why? They had a good gas pedal, but the brake pedal wasn't working. They were not instructed in the fear of the Lord. It's not enough just to have passion for Jesus. We must have the fear of the Lord like a fire in our spirit. I am persuaded there is only one brake that will stop you every time. And it's not the fear of consequences. How many have figured that one out by now? Fear of consequences didn't stop. There's only one brake that actually has the power in it to stop you in every circumstance, every point of vulnerability, every temptation, and it's this: the blazing terror of the Lord. How do we come under that kind of terror? By making a covenant with our eyes. Now, I'd like to explain why this is so fearful. And let me start by illustrating from marriage. When you first got, proposed to, you were like, I'm getting married. And then it sunk in. I'm going to stand at that altar, look him in the eye, and vow myself to him for life, for better, for worse. And we don't know which it'll be. Marriage vows, when you understand what a marriage covenant is, I mean, it's terrifying. It's like, whoa, why do we do this? Well, actually, we want to do it. It's the terror of the vow that actually secures the marriage and protects it and causes that to become a furnace of fiery marital love. We want to make the vow. And so, in the same way, a covenant with the eyes is scary. Let me just give you five reasons. I'm sure there's more, but five reasons why an eye covenant is so scary. Number one, it involves our sexuality. When Adam and Eve took the hit, sin impacted them at first brunt in their sexuality. It's the first thing they realized, we're naked. Beloved, there is no part of our being that has suffered a greater damage, perhaps, than the area of our sexuality. Why would I ever make a covenant in an area that is so broken, so weak? For some of us, has been one of our areas of failure and shame. Just the idea, the preposterous idea of making a covenant with sexuality, I mean, it just puts your knees knocking together. Reason number two, it's so scary. Knowing our weakness in this area, we realize we can't possibly fulfill this in the strength of our flesh. If we're going to fulfill this covenant, it's going to mean a daily dependence moment by moment on the Holy Spirit. And to be that dependent on God is just, well, it's just scary. Number three reason, it's frightening because of the one with whom we're making the covenant. We're laying down a marker with the Almighty Creator of heaven and earth, Lord of heaven's armies, who takes no pleasure in fools. We're saying, my eyes will not go beyond this line, and I sanctify my eyes to you only. We are doing this with God. Reason number four, it's so scary. A vow provides no room for failure. There is no provision in a covenant for blowing it. I'm going to guess, Murray, that when you got married, now I don't know for sure, but you correct me if I'm wrong. I'm going to guess when you got married, you did not have this clause in your marriage vows. Sweetheart, I covenant myself to you for life, and if I have an affair, please forgive me. When you make a covenant, there's no proviso for an affair. It's a covenant. Same thing with the Lord. We are saying it will not happen. Well, that's scary. Number five, finally, vows are frightening. Because the Bible doesn't let us back out. Once you make a vow, for however long that vow is in force, you are in it. I mean, the first morning of your honeymoon, you get up, you look at your sweetheart and go, oops. Sorry, it's too late, you're in. It's covenant. So once you make a covenant with God, there's no getting out. I mean, this is scary. So when you understand the nature of covenant and the idea of making a covenant with your eyes before God, it turns your legs to jelly. And I mean, just like, it causes the terror of the Lord to just kind of go through your entire being. And that's exactly why we do it. We want this terror. We're wise enough to welcome and embrace it. I want the terror of the Lord to run all the way through my being so that when a moment for potential compromise comes along, I want a five-alarm bell to sound. I want thunder to clap. I want a voice to go off inside of me. No, I can't go there. I stood in the presence of God. I made a covenant with Almighty God. I can't afford to. My flesh still wants to look. I'm just too scared to look. Well, if an eye coming in is this scary, you might ask, why would I ever want to make it? Because I'm persuaded it has the power to catapult us into another level of victory. A couple reasons I'd like to bring to you. Number one, vows get God involved in a greater way. God is really into vows. He just likes the covenant thing for some reason. And when you make a covenant with your eyes, he just responds to the sheer audacity of the thing. And he's like, if you'll go there, I'll go there. If you'll up the ante, I'll up the ante. And I bear witness this morning, when you make a covenant with your eyes, there comes a profound release of grace to your life that'll make you just a little bit dizzy. Number two reason, vows help us by giving us strength. That's why the Bible says, make vows to the Lord your God. Because vows, they put strength into a marriage. If you're ever tempted with infidelity, your vow comes and secures your heart and strengthens the marriage. Samson's vow strengthened him. He had a vow with his hair, and it gave him the strength to be a deliverer in Israel. We just wished he had had a covenant with his eyes. That's what took him down. He had to lose his eyes in order to see. A vow properly expressed in the grace of God will take your intimacy to a whole new level. I'm just bearing witness today. When you step into covenant, I give myself to him. He gives himself to me. I promise myself to him. He promises himself to me. And the intimacy of a vow is just really beautiful. Most believers, however, stay, when it comes to sexuality, most of us stay in the area of resolve and commitment. I can imagine someone listening to this message thinking like this, you know what? I've been living at the resolve level, seeking to walk in purity for years. And my life, I just, like, I'll blow it, then I'll, okay, repent, get the blood of Jesus, hit delete, get back up, get back in the race, and then I blow it, and then I repent, I get the blood of Jesus, hit delete, get back up, get in the race. And I've had this cyclical thing that's just been kind of badgering me for years. And for years I've been under this low-grade kind of sense of defeat and failure. I'm afraid if I make a covenant with my eyes and then blow it, I think the thing will bury me. Here's my answer to that. If you make a covenant with your eyes and violate it, it might bury you. But is it possible that the reason you've only made it up 98% of the mountain and then back down and then up to 98% and then back down, is it possible you've never been able to crest the mountain because you've been staying in the security of resolve? Is it time to burn the bridges, sell all, buy the pearl, and make a covenant with your eyes? I'm thinking it has the power to take you over the summit into a new level of victory in the grace of God. Now let me ask the question that will answer the question everybody's been wondering this morning. What will happen if I make a covenant with my eyes and then violate it? Answer: we don't know. If somebody was to ask me, Bob, what would Marcy do if you were unfaithful to her? My answer would be, I don't know. She might take me to the guillotine. She might divorce me. She might separate. She might beg for, you know, like, let's save the marriage. I don't know what she'll do. I have no intention of ever finding out. What will God do if you make a covenant with your eyes and then violate it? Nobody knows. When you look at how God handled covenant breakers in the Bible, it was the whole gamut. Some of them he killed. Some of them he chastened. Some of them, Book of Hosea, he gets down on his knees and he begs for them to come back. We don't know. So I'm going to count the cost up front and decide, if I'm going to do a covenant with my eyes, I don't want to find out what God will do if I violate it. Count the cost up front, and then make a covenant with my eyes and resolve in my heart I'm going to follow it all the days of my life. But that's why I tell folks, don't just make a fast covenant and a spontaneous, you know, on a Sunday morning when there's passion and fire and fervency in your heart, come to the altar and make a lifetime covenant to God. No, do not make a lifetime vow to God in the heat of an altar call. Take some time with that thing. Test it. Let the Lord take you through a process of discernment. If you make a covenant with your eyes and then violate it, I don't have much counsel for you. I guess I would say, get down, eat dust, and cry out for mercy. I don't know what to tell you. But if you make a covenant with your eyes, and then have a bump along the way, okay, I'll talk to you about that. See, I see a difference between a violation and a bump. Let me explain what I mean. When it comes to marriage, there's a violation of marriage, and then there's a bump. Let's suppose a man says to his wife, sweetheart, I had lustful feelings toward another woman today. It really bothered me, and I don't feel good about it. I'm confessing it to you. Would you please pray with me? And your wife will probably go, okay, sweetheart, let's fight for this thing now. And she'll pray with you. She'll contend with you. Why? It's a bump. Suppose a man says to his wife, sweetheart, I slept with another woman last night. Would you please pray for me? She's not going to pray for you. It's a violation. The same is true in our sexuality. I want to distinguish between violation and a bump. A violation, okay, if you make a covenant with your eyes and then you go to a site, a porn site, and just kind of baptize yourself in a porn site, that's a violation. I don't have much counsel for you. But if you have a bump in your covenant, okay, let me talk to you about it. I've experienced some bumps along the way. Let me give you an example. This happened to me. I'm in the grocery store. I'm in the line to check out, and there's some people in front of me. I'm waiting my turn. And as I'm standing in line, they've got these magazines that flank me on my left and right. And I go like this, and I go, oh, I don't look at that stuff. And then muscles in my neck that I did not know existed I don't know how it happened to this day. I have no idea how it happened. Something turned, and I took a second look. First look, okay. Second look, that's not allowed by my covenant. And I'm standing in the grocery line going, Lord, how did that just, what just happened? I just took a second look. No, I call this a bump. Lord, forgive me. I don't want it to be like this. I want it to be that. Every time I never take that second look, I'm asking for grace and help right now. Cleanse me right now. And so I'm praying that in the grocery. And here's what I've discovered. When you're bumping your way through your eye covenant like that, your beloved is not like a referee who is holding a flag and ready to throw that thing down at the first infraction. I've discovered he is a lovesick bridegroom who looks at the covenant you've made, whose heart moves for you, who is celebrating the fervency and the consecration that you've offered to him. He is your greatest advocate. He is your biggest cheerleader. And he is going, I love this. And here's the verse he gave me. Song of Solomon 4:1. You have dove's eyes behind your veil. He says to me, as I'm bumping my way through this thing, I love the way you've set your eyes upon me. I love the fervency and the consecration of your heart. The vow is your veil. You have dove's eyes behind your veil. Now let's ask the question, how might Job 31 verse 1 apply to women? Every guy in the house this morning, I don't have to convince any guys in the house, you're tracking with me. It's like covenant with my eyes. I get you. What about the women in the room? As I was going to write this book on covenant with my eyes, I'm talking to my wife. I said, sweetheart, I'm very comfortable writing to the guys because I am one. I have no idea how to write to women. So my wife and I, we called a group of women to come over to our house. We sat them down, and here's what I said to them. I said, okay, if the gate to a man's sexuality is his eyes, what's the gate to a woman's sexuality? If a man needs to make a covenant with his eyes, what does a woman need to make a covenant with? If temptation wants to get access through the eyes to the heart, what is it in a woman that is the gate that allows temptation to get to her thought life, where the fantasies and imaginations happen? What's the gate? The women talked it around. You know what they said to me? They said, the gate to a woman's sexuality is also the eyes. I was unprepared for that answer. I mean, they were telling me things that put me on tilt. I'm like, what, talk to me here. And I'm thinking, okay, I must have gotten the world's freakiest women in one room at one time. So I called together another group of women, and I did the whole thing all over again. And then I sent out a raft of emails literally around the world. I mean, young, old, married, single, various ethnicities. I'm like, help me, talk to me. Almost without exception, the women came back to me with the same answer. The gate to a woman's sexuality, the primary gate, it's the same as for men, it's the eyes. And that's just about where the similarities end. So I made some conclusions based on my interaction with them. My first conclusion, the invitation of Job 31 verse 1 is universal. It's available if you want it. It's available today to men and women alike. My second observation was, there is no universal way that women are triggered in their sexuality. As I was talking to the woman, this woman would say, well, here's how it works for me. This woman would say, it doesn't work anything like that for me. The women didn't agree with the women. And I'm trying to figure this thing out. About the only thing I figured out is, women are complex. Actually, what they told me, I wasn't ready for this either. They said, women look at men, but they said, women look at women. And they clarified, not in a lesbian way. They said, women look at women in a comparing way. They measure their own sense of self-worth and attractiveness based on how they feel they measure up to other women. And I don't have the thing figured out. All I know is this. Here's the bottom line on it. However you work as a woman, you are invited, if you want to craft a covenant for your eyes that addresses the uniqueness of who you are individually, what your trigger points are, what your points of vulnerability are. I talk in chapter 12 of this book. I have a chapter addressed to women. And I'm just going to put a disclaimer out there right now, if you don't mind. There is nothing in chapter 12 that is original. It's all the stuff I collected from the other women. So ladies, if you have a problem with chapter 12, your problem is not with me. There's a number of questions that I just can't get to today for the sake of time, and I address them in the book, and so I'm hoping that if you have unanswered questions, that the book can be a blessing to you. I deal with the question of masturbation. I deal with the question of, is it biblical for us to even make vows in the New Covenant era? Somebody says, well, Jesus didn't make vows. I'm not making vows. And actually, I make a case in the book. I think Jesus did make vows. And I'll give you a little hint. Psalm 22. Try to substantiate that. And here's what I want to do today, because I'm with my spiritual family this morning and I'm just stoked to be with you. I am giving a free copy of this book to every single person in this room that promises to read it. So if you're willing to go through the book on the way out this morning, you got to go this way because they don't have them at this exit, but go out this way. They got a free copy. Just grab it. It's yours. And the bookstore's doing a great special today. If you want extra copies for Christmas or friends or family, they got a $5 deal that you can't pass up today. So let me sow this into your life. If you want to read it, it's yours. It's my gift to you. Let me close with this simple thought, please. Vows can be lifelong, or they can be for a specific period of time. There were some in the Bible that made vows for life, such as Samson, Samuel, John the Baptist. But the Nazarites in the book of Numbers, chapter 6, the Nazarites would typically make vows for a specific period of time. So my point is, to make a covenant with your eyes, it does not have to be for life. You can make a covenant with your eyes for a day. test drive it, enjoy the victory, and make an eye covenant for 3 days. Feel the grace on that thing, and make an eye covenant for a week. And then I'm going for a month. And then I'm going to do it for a year. I'm telling you right now, I'm being a little prophetic, okay? You make an eye covenant with God for a year. By the end of that year, I think I've got a convert. I think you're going to sign up for the rest of your life because you will enjoy a dimension of grace and empowerment in the heart of God that you won't look back and you'll say, I'm in it for life, and that's the prayer of my heart. So at the end of your notes here this morning, there is a suggested a template, if you will, for a covenant that you can make with God. I invite you to consider it. You're welcome. If you want to make a covenant for a day, for 3 days, we're entering the global bridegroom fast, and maybe for the next 7 days, something in your heart would say, I'm going to make a covenant with my eyes for the next 7 days, and then find out. I mean, what kind of grace might God want to release in your life? So let's just respond to the Lord now in our hearts. Holy Spirit, I'm asking you to come now in the way that you do so perfectly to personalize this word to every heart. And Lord, those that you are making an invitation to, I'm asking there would be a release of grace in this house to make a covenant with you with their eyes for the next 1 day, 3 days, 7 days, whatever you're offering. I just want to make clear that there is no compulsion on this. The book of Deuteronomy is very clear. Vows are always voluntary. There's no compulsion, there's no obligation, there's no pressure. It's an invitation from the Lord. It's between you and God. Take some time with it if you need to, whatever time you need. But now, in your heart, just begin to say yes to Jesus.